All right, you're on.
Right, so we're doing 1 Corinthians, where there's lots of problems in the church and Paul is sorting them out.
Yeah.
We're going to get right into it as quick as we can. One of the keys to understanding 1 and 2 Corinthians is we have to have a handle on what was going on, because then we know what he's talking about. Otherwise, we're like, well, he's so extreme on something, and what's the problem with it? Things like that. So we want to know what was happening. We've only got 1 and 2 Corinthians, but there were at least 4 letters to the Corinthian church that Paul wrote in this whole drama. We've only got 2 of them. That may be a good thing, because some of the other ones might not have been nice. But these are the 2 we've got left, and so we have to fill in the gaps, read between the lines, and work out what's going on. We'll go through all of that in a minute. Let's look at this here. I looked up Corinthian in an online dictionary, several. This one had the best definitions that I could find. How many people have heard of Corinthian Doors? It's a company that makes doors for houses. Anyone heard of that?
Yeah.
How many people got doors from their house, for their house, from Corinthian Doors?
Yeah.
Why do they call their doors Corinthian Doors? Are they Christians? They're telling people that they're not Christians. It's not because it's a biblical reference. Architecture, luxury. It's all about luxury / architecture. That's the meaning. If you look, some of these meanings here, relating to Corinth, of course, but Corinth was famous for architecture. So / architecture, Corinthian. Elegant and ornate, licentious and profligate luxury. That means completely over-the-top indulgent luxury. Okay? Corinth was not a poor town. Yep. Corinth was a rich town. Basically, we'll get a minute. It was a very rich town. So he's writing to rich people. He's not writing to poor people. And so their problems are different than the poor people's problems. They have a lot more problems with overindulgence than with a crisis of famine or something like that. Number 2 down on the second noun, a luxury-loving person. Licentious and profligate luxury. They were, what that basically means is no rules, I'll do anything I like. So they were Corinthians, highly immoral. They didn't have any standards or anything like that to speak of. They were quite, anything goes, we've got enough money, who's going to tell us off? Right? We're the rich people. So we'll do whatever we like. But this is the map of the city. Now, where is Corinth? Let's have a quick look. Corinth is here. The way it works was, when you were bringing your boat full of cargo to trade to people, there was this, you could get so far, then there was like a bit you couldn't get across to get to the other side, a land peninsula thing. And it was a long way to sail all the way around and back the other side. You were much better off, welcome, I'm out. Glad you can make it, because you're in for a great time. You were much better off to pick up your boat, carry it across the ground to the other side. So the people at Corinth made lots of money by being boat carriers or organising boats. So the boats would come in with all their stuff. They'd stop, get off the beach. The people would, all the slaves, would pick up the boats and also carry it the 1 mile or 2 miles, whatever it was, put it in the water on the other side, and that would save them a couple of days' journey. But of course, to do that, you had to pay someone. So people were making money out of this trade. And so that's it became quite a busy trade centre, busy business centre. So that's how they got quite wealthy. Who were the people that went to Corinth? If you read the book of Acts, Paul went there, started the church there. The other people that went there is Priscilla and Aquila. You've heard of them. Paul was preaching. Priscilla and Aquila came, and they helped plant the church, very key in the church. Apollos is the other big name that we'll come across. He was a preacher that came down to the Corinthians and spent a lot of time with them. And he was very beneficial for the church, because he would have debates with the local Jewish synagogue, and he'd always win, because he was a very eloquent speaker, and he could always catch them out, and he would prove that Jesus was the Messiah, and all the Jewish teachers and stuff would be like, what do you say now? So he was a great help to the church there. Paul was there for 18 months, and then he went off to Ephesus. So if we follow the journey, where does it go? It's that way. Paul goes here, around here. He's done these churches here, Philippi, Thessalonica, blah, blah. Comes down here to Corinth. And after he's been there, he crosses over to Ephesus. Ephesus is important because that's a really big church. That was really one of their base churches. Timothy was based there. The book of Ephesians, obviously, is written there. Very influential church in the area. And so Paul was based there for a while. And after Paul had gone there, then Apollos went to Corinth. Yes, and he was a very good preacher. Now that's where we get to one of the first problems was Apollos was too good a preacher. So they started fighting over who was best, Paul or Apollos. So what we've got, we want to get the story of what happens in the background, about 55 AD. Paul's gone to Ephesus. Paul's gone to all these churches. He gets to Corinth. He stays there for about a year and a half. Then he goes off to other churches, and he writes them a letter, like a follow-up letter. How are you guys doing? Is everything all right? The Corinthian people send a letter back to Paul, and they also get messengers from some people there come to Paul, and they tell him that things are not good. So he hears all this stuff, so he writes 1 Corinthians back. I've heard, after I've left you guys, you tell me things aren't going wrong. I've got to sort you out, correct you, because you've got a whole lot of things wrong. And then after that, there's another letter which we don't have, which he refers to as his letter of tears. He says, I wrote you with many tears. There's another letter, because after 1 Corinthians, the people of Corinth didn't actually appreciate his comments. So they became more hostile, and so he wrote a letter of tears, which we don't have a copy of. And then he writes 2 Corinthians later, because he was supposed to go back. He said, I'm going to come back, I'm going to sort all this out and bring you into line. And he didn't come back. He had to go somewhere else. So he says, look, I'm sorry I can't come now, and this is what you need to know. And he sent him a letter to go before him because he couldn't come. Like, 1 Corinthians is very easy to read. It's very, very well structured. He obviously had time to think about it. He probably had their letter in front of him. He read it and wrote, okay, yeah, da-da-da-da-da. Now, your next question is this. It talks about that for a chapter or two. Next question, talk about it for two chapters. I've heard about this. It's very structured. You can easily break into chapters. So we can pretty well figure out the things that were going on. And here's our overview. Introduction. And then chapter 1 to chapter 6, he responds to the things he's heard from people at Corinth. And then in chapter 7 to 16, he responds to the questions in their letters. It's very simple. He says, now, about the things you wrote me about. You asked me about this, and you asked me about this, and so he answers all their questions. And then he has the final closing off where he tells them about what's happening next and who they should thank and all that sort of thing. He signs it with his name and all that sort of stuff. Right, okay, first big problem they had was fighting over the preachers. Who was the best preacher? There's a lot. We see this here in chapter 1. Some of you say, I follow Paul. Others say, I follow Apollos. Others say, I follow Cephas, that's Peter. And others, I follow Christ. Now, this is important. He's got to fix this one up first, because large portions of the church, when they hear this letter from Paul, aren't even going to listen. They're not really listening because we don't even follow Paul. Apollos is our preacher man. And so he has this big introductory thing where actually you guys have totally got it all wrong. If you've got a favourite preacher, you've completely missed the point. You don't understand how the kingdom of God works. He comes in very strongly on what they should do. We're going to read a couple of scriptures because this is really important. His attitude, we learn a lot in Corinthians because it's dealing with whether he should be their preacher, their apostle, about his heart and our understanding of how Christian ministry works. Because he tells us how Christian ministry works. So let's start with Jane, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 11 to 12. And then Christy can do 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 to 5. And then Sharon can do 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 5 to 7. And while that's all happening, some of you are really helpful. It's going to get me my Bible. I don't even know where it is. It's on the floor at the back. Okay, Jane, are you good? 1 Corinthians chapter 2, 1 to 11 as well.
My brothers and sisters, some from
Chloe's
household
that informed me that day. So you hear that? Some people from Chloe's house, who was obviously a church leader, came to Paul and said, hey, listen what's going on in our church, it's really bad.
Informed me that there are quarrels among you. What I mean is this. One of you says, I follow Paul.
Okay, so Christy, what have you got? So he said, He's actually glad that there's no reason for them to be followers of Paul. He said, I'm glad I didn't baptize any of you hardly. Oh, yeah, I baptized one person, maybe another person, but what are you doing dividing up the church of God into people like fan clubs? I'm really glad, actually, that you can't say, oh, I followed Paul because he baptized me. I'm glad there's hardly anyone I baptized, because that's actually better. But yeah, keep going. What have you got?
1 Corinthians 2:25. And so it was with me, brothers and sisters. When I came to you, I did not come with eloquence or human wisdom, as I proclaimed to you the testimony about God. For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I came to you with weakness and with great fear and trembling. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power.
Yes. That is key passage number one. You really need to get that. He's very strong. He didn't come. He's not a flash preacher. He's not eloquent. He's not a well-trained debater or anything like that. He came in weakness. He came in fear. There was nothing impressive about him. It's just like the Bible says about Jesus in Psalm 53. There was nothing in his appearance that would make us want him. He was despised and he rejected. And Paul says, I was just the same. I didn't want to have anything. I didn't want to bring you anything except Jesus Christ, him crucified. Okay, so I didn't come to you with great political arguments or emotional arguments or anything flash. He cut back his whole message. The only thing he preached was Jesus Christ on the cross, and there's a reason for that. The reason was when they got saved, they weren't getting talked into it by a flash talker. They weren't getting tricked into it by someone offering them money. The only reason they were saved was because they had an encounter with the power of God.
Yeah.
So he says, my message and preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power. So your faith would not rest on men's wisdom, but God's power.
Mm-hmm.
So when Paul led people to Christ, it was because they had a power encounter, just like he had.
Mm-hmm.
There was nothing. Actually, we would probably find his preaching boring. We would probably switch off really quickly. Even the story in the book of Acts, when he's preaching, people fall asleep. Okay? And they fall out of the house. And they kill themselves and land in an occupational health and safety problem. But when that happens, he raises them from the dead. Then there's a power encounter and people start getting saved. So he was very strong that there was nothing impressive about him except a demonstration of the Spirit's power. And when that came, people were saved and they weren't easily talked out of it because they'd seen God face to face. They had a power encounter. And so he's very strong in this throughout Corinthians. Don't look at me and expect something flash from me. Look to Jesus, the power encounter, the presence of the Holy Spirit. Remember in Galatians, he said, did you receive the Spirit? Did you have miracles and signs because you followed the law? No. You had it because you believed God and His Spirit came in great power. And this is really a challenge for us, 21st century westernized churches. We're great with wise words and impressive things, but we don't have much power.
Yeah.
And so we really need to come back to this and start seeking after God. This is why Joel's really pushing even our church now for revival and mercy night prayer, because we need to have what Paul had, the power of the Holy Spirit backing up and coming through whatever we say.
Yep.
It's easy to talk people into coming to church. You put on a good show. But if you want them to stick it, actually come follow Jesus, they need to have a power encounter.
Yep.
And so that's really what we want to get out of Paul's understanding. We must have a power encounter with Jesus for people to be saved and stay saved.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what was our next verse? That was Sharon, right?
Yep. Chapter 3, verses 5-7. What after all is Apollos, and what is Paul? Only servants through whom you came to believe, as the Lord has assigned to each his task. I planted the seed, Apollos watered, but God made it grow. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow.
Yes, that's right. So here we get Paul telling us, if you're in the ministry, if you're serving God, this should be your perspective. You are nothing. Okay, what we do is plant seeds. We do our feeble little bit. The Holy Spirit, God, is the one that makes it grow. One person builds here. We're all a team working together, doing very little. And it's God that makes it go. It's always God's work that's happening. And we're partners with Him, but there should never be attention to us. Whenever there's a powerful Christian ministry, it must not bring attention to the people doing it, because as soon as the attention's on the people, the attention's of Jesus, Holy Spirit, is no longer bringing glory to Christ. So the Spirit's going to fade away. We need to make sure we're always putting the attention onto Jesus,
yes,
and not on ourselves.
Yeah.
This is a big challenge for people that are going to carry significant roles, in, even in just our church or nationally, internationally, whatever. there's such a thing, there is such a strong push to get recognition. If I do this role in the church, if I do that role, which people will love me, the pastor will know my name, and then I'll be important. And that's a real play that takes away the Holy Spirit, because it's all self-promotion.
Yeah.
So we've got to make sure, search our hearts, and make sure we're not doing anything to make people look at us. And it's very hard, because you're all here looking at me right now. Okay? And it wouldn't work if you weren't looking at me. So it's a great challenge. The great challenge of Lucifer was people looked at all the angels looked at him and he was puffed up. And the same challenge is to every person that has any role in the house of God. We don't want to be puffed up by Lucifer and draw attention away from Christ. So that's the big thing. And Paul is really strong on that all through Corinthians. And these people got it totally wrong. Because they had the wisdom of the world, and they were all going on because in their time, wisdom was really important. They had the Greek philosophers like Aristotle and Plato and stuff. Were very well respected. If you were really wise and articulate, then you were esteemed more and higher. And you could talk well, that was really important. And Paul's saying, you've all got, it's all nothing. All that does, then your church here has brought division. All you've done is brought competition and competing over who's got the best words, who can make the best sermon, and there's like rivalry and competition and jealousy. All of that's brought evil into the church through that whole thing of looking at elevating one person over another.
Is it better not to serve if you have that attitude than to be out there doing that?
It's better to deal with the attitude.
Mm.
It's better for people to get saved through someone who's ungodly than not get saved at all.
Mm.
This was a real challenge to me, because I was always brought up in the thing, holy vessels for God. But I read in one of the books Paul's writing that some people are preaching now. I'm in prison now. And this has stirred up some other people to preach. Other people are fired up for the gospel because I'm suffering. Other people are preaching because they want me to get in more trouble. They said Paul's in prison, and if we keep preaching the gospel, they'll be really cross with him for starting this revival, and he'll get more whippings in prison. And he says, I don't care. As long as they're preaching the gospel and people are getting saved, bring it on, let me have more trouble. Bad motives from them, I don't mind. I'm still glad that they're preaching. So that was a real challenge for me, because I thought he wanted to sort themselves out. But keep preaching the gospel and sort yourself out on the way. But yes. Okay, problem number one, all of that. And what do we do about divisions in the church? You need to come back and remember that it's not about any of us. Put Jesus back on the throne and anything. This is a real problem, because our society likes to elevate people. Movie stars, music performers, we like to elevate sports fans. We want to lift up people as heroes. And we actually don't want that happening in the church. We want people to lift up Jesus. So it's a constant challenge for us to deal with. Okay, the next problem we've got is confusion over things that we used to do before we were Christians, and now we don't realise that actually that's not okay. There's an incest problem. Remember, Corinthians have very little morals, okay? Sex is for anyone at any time, basically. Now, they've got this guy here, who his father's obviously got multiple wives, and he's hooked up with one of his father's wives.
Oh.
And he thinks it's awesome. And he says, Paul even says, why are you boasting about this? You should have got rid of this guy out of your church. Possibly it was a criminal offence, and they should have been harbouring a fugitive, possibly. Possibly they were boasting about it because he was rich. If he was a rich person, a rich leader in the church, and half of the church are his servants, and depend on him for their housing and their income and blah, 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 who's going to stand up against him and say, excuse me, that's immoral behaviour, you shouldn't be in our church.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, the church meets at my house. I'll do what I like, thank you very much. So there may have been something of that going on.
Mm-hmm.
There may have been the whole, God has freed me from the law, I'm now freedom in Christ, I can do whatever I like. Here I go, look, I'm so free. Jesus has so freed me, I've got no restriction on what I can do. So it could have been that, because that's what he said, don't use your freedom in Galatians as an excuse for a sinful nature. So, but whatever it was, they were boasting about this problem that they had. And so he was very cross on them, in that he really said, there's no room in God's house for people who are sexually immoral. So you've got to get this guy out. So he's very strong on that. And this carries through into, it's referred to again, possibly this guy in 2 Corinthians. The next thing that's going on is lawsuits among believers. People are taking each other, the Christians are taking each other to court. The thing we need to know is that, situation-wise, if you went to court, it was like at the food hall at Gateway Shopping Centre, right? There'll be a big stand there, and there'll be the judges will be sitting there, and if you had a complaint against someone else, both of you would be on the stand and you'd make your complaint and the other person would answer and the judges would listen and make a decision. So of course, it's public court, everyone is listening. So all the passers-by are seeing this guy who's supposed to be a Christian and this guy who's supposed to be a Christian, and they're having this big argument about something like, you didn't pay me rent, you dented my car, whatever it was that they're trying to get money off the other people for. And Paul has this great statement. I want us to read 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 7 and 8. Sean, are you ready with that?
1 Corinthians.
Chapter 6, verse 7 and 8. Who's got it? Racing down the line. That's 1 minute more we don't have for our drink time.
Did you say 3?
Chapter 6, verse 7 and 8. Who's got it? I'm looking.
No.
I'm looking. Melanie's got it.
1 Corinthians chapter 6?
Yeah, verse 7 and 8.
7 and
8. Yeah.
The very fact that you have lawsuits among you means you have been completely defeated already. Why not rather be wronged? Why not rather be cheated? Instead, you yourselves cheat and do wrong, and you do this to your brothers and sisters.
Alrighty. So that's his summary of the problem. What is he, what? Someone tell me, what is he saying? What is, they have, you guys having lawsuits now, then? And he says, the fact that you've got lawsuits among yourselves means you've already been completely defeated. So who's won? If they've lost, who's won?
No.
The devil. That's right. The devil's completely won. The church here is completely in defeat. Okay? Because they're fighting amongst themselves, having lawsuits. Why is that a complete defeat? Are they supposed to get rid of their sin? Now, what is Paul? What is so bugging Paul that he says they've been completely defeated? Sean?
Because wrongdoers won't inherit the kingdom of God.
Yes, number one, there shouldn't be people. You shouldn't be... giving any reason, if there's someone there ripping people off, if there's a church guy who's doing dodgy deals and dodgy workmanship, ripping people off, and so they're trying to take them to court to get their money back, well, that's no good. That should not be happening in your church. You should be, especially the brothers, you should be serving in the best.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that's true. What else? Anything else?
You're giving a bad example of what
Christians... That's a horrendous example of what Christians are like. That's right. Because Christians fighting against each other, that... As you read the New Testament, in every book, you're going to see what Paul says about the body of Christ. First, you're arguing about who's the best preacher. Now you're arguing over money and stuff. Fighting and stuff, hostility between Christians should never happen. And his understanding, the body of Christ, you were all darkness, now you're all light. You're all united with the same spirit. There should be nothing coming between you. That's just a betrayal of the whole gospel, if there's any sort of thing coming between you like that. You've already been defeated. It's better off to let someone take your money and rip you off, than for it to cause division in the church. As he said, it's better to be wrong. Let's just read that again, chapter 6, 7, 8. The fact that you have lawsuits among you means you've been completely defeated. Why not rather be wrong and rather be cheated? Rather be cheated and wrong than have division and conflict and fighting. Because conflict and fighting between Christians, just let it go. I'm blessing you, brother. I'm not going to cause this to cause a fight between us, you know. Because remember, you never know what day the Roman soldiers are going to knock at your door and say, who's a Christian? I'm going to take you all to jail. You know, they had a reason to be, like, united together. And any reason to be betraying each other, that's not going to be good. But the same for us, there should be nothing that is so important that it causes us to be hostile to a brother and sister.
Yeah.
The kingdom of God, the name of Jesus, the united by that, should always be higher. Now that's really challenging for us, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because all our churches, we spend half our time all that long with fights between people, right? People are always fighting, they've always got issues, and we obviously don't know what Paul knew about interpersonal dynamics.
Yes.
We don't get it. The whole point of this whole letter probably is a problem, because there's divisions among the church, they're fighting with him, that's probably why he was so upset about it, but we really need to elevate our game and how we deal with other people.
Yeah.
That we're so quick to barrier, hostility, fight, rather than just, well, if there's a problem, if he's hurt me in some way, I'll just leave that with Jesus. It's Jesus he's talking to, not me, and just remembering that it's actually Jesus' money that he's now got. There's no pride on me. Remember, I'm nothing. It doesn't matter if they say bad things about me. Well, I'm nothing anyway, remember. It's God that does the work. That sort of humble attitude will really help us to not be so quickly drawn into fighting and arguing and stuff like that. Okay, third one, chapter 6, 12 to 20, they had this problem that the way things worked in Corinth, you go to a dinner party, normally what would happen is some sort of like a party thing, if they're watching the footy and they're having a party afterwards, they wouldn't have a barbecue, right? They would have huge amount of food, huge amount of alcohol, and if they were still standing, whatever, then in would come the, what they would call the high quality professional prostitutes. And no party was complete with all through. Okay, and so this is where, not only that, but this is where the business of the town would be conducted. If you're having a, say they're having some town business or like a business meeting, and you want to work out the new deal with your contracts you're organising, you'd have a big feast, you'd invite all the people from the other company and your business leaders or whatever, and you'd put on the big food, the big drink, probably sacrifice to an idol or two, and have the prostitutes come in for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And depending on how good it all was whether you'd get the sale.
Mm-hmm.
That's how the whole thing ran. And Paul's got, hold on guys, you've now completely missed out. This is totally different. Kingdom of God is totally different, and we need to realise that. The short answer of what he's saying is, and again challenging for us, one of the things is in their time, a lot of people thought that the spirit was everything and the body was nothing. Physical was of no value, spiritual was important. So it didn't really matter what happened in your physical body, because it's what your spirit's doing that counts. Okay, so on the one hand, you would starve yourself and you'd whip yourself and your physical body doesn't matter, it's just making my spirit stronger.
Yeah.
Okay, and Paul was against that. He said, no, your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. You should honour it and care for it and look after it.
Mm.
But then the flip side of that is it doesn't matter what my body's doing. So if I'm drinking lots and getting wasted, if I'm prostitutes and stuff, it doesn't matter because my spirit is still holy. My spirit's with Jesus, that's all that matters. It's seated in heavenly places and my spirit is fine. What happens on earth doesn't really matter because it's all going to burn in hell, doesn't matter. So that extreme, the opposite way. And Paul's both of those get completely off. Paul's really elevates against other religious teachings of the time. Your body's a temple of the Holy Spirit. Jesus is in you. So whatever you're doing, Jesus is doing. And this is, we love to say this, when we feed the poor, when we do LTN, we're the hands and feet of Jesus touching the lost out in our community. And that's wonderful. But exactly the same time, when those guys are going out to the prostitutes, or when they're getting stoned or drunk or whatever, that's the hand and feet of Jesus that are touching the prostitute, or drinking the alcohol, or being whatever they're doing. Whatever they're doing, not only your ministry is the hands and feet of Jesus, but everything that you're doing is hands and feet of Jesus. So are you going to take the body of Jesus and unite him with the prostitute? Very challenging. He really doesn't hold back. But that's... Now, I have a question, because just to... challenge us a little bit. Do you think, a little discussion, do you think sexual immorality, which is what he's talking about, is worse than any other sin? Is it the same as other sins, or is it worse than other sins?
Well,
there's a tendency often to say that it's a worse sin. Okay, now what do you think?
I would say all sins are the same.
So over here we say it's the same? 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 Everyone says the same?
Yeah.
All sins are the same.
No,
all sins are the same. I'm sorry, you haven't read your Bible. Yes, Mona? That's exactly right. Let's read our Bibles.
Yep.
1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18 and 19. Flee from sexual immorality. All other sins a man commits are outside his body. But he who sins sexually sins against his own body. That's right. You're now corrupting. Your body is supposed to be a holy temple for the Holy Spirit. And now you're damaging it and corrupting it and destroying it. That's the same as taking the statue of the Roman gods and putting it in the temple in Jerusalem, the abomination that causes desolation. Exactly the same thing, because you're taking the unholy and putting the unholy into it. Yes, sure.
What about things like drugs and alcohol then?
Drugs and alcohol would be close, yes. They would be close because you're defiling the body as well.
Yeah, what about tattoos?
What about tattoos?
I'm pretty stuffed then.
What about tattoos? It depends. I think immorality has a special thing on its own because it involves, I think he's specifically said sexual immorality because you're uniting yourself with someone else and that's supposed to be but you could expand it if you're damaging the temple of the Holy Spirit, then you could say so.
Say damaging is decorating.
Yeah, well, that's it. Considered as, you're damaging the temple of the Holy Spirit. Unhealthy. And you should be fleeing, not sort of, that's why he doesn't necessarily, he doesn't say flee from, even from greed or flee from jealousy, but sexual immorality, because it's obviously has a higher level of impact on your life. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. It is not even your own, so therefore everything you do with your body should honor God. And that's his summary statement at the end of chapter 6. Everything you're doing with your body should be honoring God. So he's really challenging, and that's a challenge for us, because, as again, it's easy to say with sexual immorality, but everything we do should be honoring God with our body. So we want to make sure that what we're doing is honoring God. And sometimes we want to think about that. Maybe that should be our homework. Think about it. Think about, set a timer on your phone for every half an hour. Ping, what am I doing now? Is it honoring God? And just see how it goes. That would be a really cool test to see how many times you're like, maybe I should stop this. I don't think Jesus, the hands and feet of Jesus, maybe shouldn't be doing this. Maybe. That's just something to examine yourself and see how you're going on that. Is it honoring God? Okay. Stuff, right? Chapter 5, verse 9. I just want to zip back a little bit. Where he's talking about immorality and stuff, he says, I have written to you in my letter that you should not associate with sexually immoral people. So now, first thing we get is, okay, so he's already written them a letter. There was a letter before 1 Corinthians, and he was telling them the standards for godly living. But verse 10, not at all meaning the people of this world who are immoral, or greedy, or swindlers, and idolaters. There's those things we always hear about. In that case, you'd have to leave the world. But now, I'm clarifying what I wrote to you before. Anyone who calls himself a Christian, but is sexually immoral, or greedy, or idolater, do not even eat with these people, because it's... Why would he say that? Just out of interest, let's pause. Why would he be so harsh if someone's greedy, a drunkard, or a swindler, or an idol worshipper, or sexually immoral? Paul says, I don't want you to hang out with them at all. Why would he say that?
Is that because you could be influenced by them?
I would say exactly right. He says in another book, a little bit of yeast works through the whole loaf of bread, and sin is like that, and some sins are more contagious than others, and obviously these ones are highly contagious. And he's saying, actually, it's not going to do you, it's not going to do the testimony in the church any good, it's not going to do you any good, it's not going to do them any good. His response to this guy was, they need to push to disassociate him from the church, because while he's in the comfort of the church, he's still under the blessing of God, he's not going to get any challenge to repent. But when he's outside the blessing and outside the fellowship, then there's opportunity for him to feel the weight of his sin and the need to repent and say, yes.
How soon after getting saved would he be saying that? Like, people don't change straight away.
How soon after he's got saved should he say that? That's got to be the sermon of the Holy Spirit every time. But he's already written them a previous letter.
Yeah.
And they have been going, the church has been going for 18 months. And after that time, he wrote them a letter. And now this is the second time he's had that letter. So there's obviously a process involved there. Very good question. And yeah, this guy was probably already a Christian before this event happened. Yes.
I was going to say, is that still in context for us now?
That's a really good question as well. Is that still in context for us now? Should we kick half the people in our church out of our church? Is that what you're asking me?
Just
should she associate with them as all she
should personally associate with people? It's a tricky question on the one hand, but you should not have close fellowship. I'll say that. Close fellowship should be for the people that are building you up, making you strong, feeding you like-minded. The people out there, there's definitely two camps. There's the people that you can share your heart with, that will build you up and make you strong in the Lord. Yeah. And there's the people that you're trying to win for Jesus and you know they're not right with God. Yeah. And there's two separate things. And people basically will have to be in one of those boxes or the other. Yeah. And so those people like this, you can't afford to have them being the ones that are giving you counsel on your spiritual life or your personal life or something like that. You have to have people that are godly, demonstrating wisdom and maturity to be those people. Yes.
Well, like, how can you tell sometimes, though? Because some people are, like, just really good at, like...
How can you tell? Well, if you don't know, you don't know. Okay? Of course. yes, of course. If you don't, and those days it was more public. Everything was a lot more public, I think, because everyone knows who's gone to the temple. Everything was a lot more public. And the whole eating together was a lot more... Even that was more significant. When you were eating at the same table, you were it was like loyalty. We are, you know, brothers together. It's like a very... tight unity thing. If you're eating at someone's table, that's a sign of great loyalty and commitment to each other. Whereas sitting at the same table at McDonald's, well, whatever, no big deal. So there's a few differences there. So what we do is we see a culture difference. The principle is Make sure that you're not drawn away by someone else's sin.
Mm.
Be a, make sure that you're not condoning, but you're letting people know what is and isn't okay for a Christian. Those would be the principles, and how we work them out in our culture might be slightly different. But we have to maintain those principles. We don't want people to be led astray by people that don't live a godly life and have influence in the church. We don't want ourselves to be led astray, so we have to be wise about the relationships we're building. And so we have to deal with those things, maybe in a slightly different way, but the principles that he was operating from are the things that we need to make sure we're outworking in our 21st century context. Okay, very good. That was great. I'm loving this. This is good stuff.
Have you read the recent report in the news? I think it's a Catholic priest or Anglican priest who has come out that he's gay.
Yeah.
And I think the bishop has accepted him, and all he wants, he doesn't want any attention drawn to him at all about being a gay priest. He just wants to go on about doing his work that he's doing for God.
Yeah, so that's a controversial question about people, homosexual people being ministers in the church. The issue that's dividing the church across the world right now, some churches are saying, well, hey, God loves everyone, let's just welcome everyone into the house of God. Some churches are saying, actually, there's some things that are not okay and should not be accepted. It's a God's kingdom, God's ways are different than this world's ways, and at some point you've got to say no. And so that's dividing the church right now. Yes. But based on this principle here, it would be obviously not a thing you would want to be someone mentoring your young people in the ways of God.
No.
Yeah? Interesting. That's right. Okay, the next chapter, he talks about, he says, now about the things you wrote me about. Chapter 7, verse 1. Now for the matters you wrote me about. It is good for a man not to marry. But since there is so much immorality, each man should have his own wife and each woman their own husband. Okay, now, there's some things we need to figure out. Chapter 6, verse 12, for example, it says, everything is permissible for me. How many people can find chapter 6, verse 12? Just find that in your Bibles. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12. Put your hands on your head when you got it. You actually need to be looking at it if you can get what I'm saying. How many can tell me what's different, something special about chapter 6, verse 12, the first half of the verse? What's special about it? Grammar, punctuation is what I'm talking about. I better make sure some of your Bibles, any of your Bibles are the same as mine. Yes, yours has got it. Yep. Quote marks. Quote marks. Why are there quote marks around that statement?
He's quoting them.
He's quoting them, exactly right. He's quoting them, and then after that he gives his, yes, that's true, but. So they say, everything is permissible for me, then he says, but not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. Now, just side note, those are two really good principles for working out stuff. If you're not sure if it's okay, let's maybe, everything is permissible, because we're not under a law of a whole lot of what you can and can't do, you can and can't say. Okay, is it legal or not? Should you wear hats in church? Okay, everything is permissible, but not everything is beneficial. Okay, so yes, you're not going to go to hell for doing it, but is it doing you any good? That's the first question. Second one, I will not be mastered by anything. There's a lot of things that are not sin, except for the fact that they make you a slave. And if you become a slave to it, you're no longer free to respond whenever God calls you. Now, here we go. I realised this when I was a young fella. I had my tape recorder, and I had my Christian music on it. And I would come home from, I think it was school or uni or something like that. I'd come home from, and I'd turn on the music and I'd just do my thing, right? And then one day, I found myself walking in and doing my thing, and the Holy Spirit really prompted me, you could not do a day without your music. And I was really challenged, and actually I'd made such a habit, I'd become a slave, that my mind wasn't free. I just put myself in a routine that was actually a compulsive, I was compelled now. If I was sitting down and the music wasn't there, I was like, turn it on. So there was a compulsion within me, and that's not a good thing. I'm not going to be mastered by anything, even by the desire for Christian music. Okay, so there's a real thing that we need to get a hold of, or we don't want to be masked, anything that compels us, that we find we don't have the choice, yes or no, then that's something we want to, over time, mature and grow out of, so that we're completely free. Because like Paul says, and this would have been hard for Paul, because he was a Jew, and he was compelled to always eat the Jews' food only, right? But when he goes to a Gentile's house, he had to force himself to eat pork or other stuff that had been offered to idols and do non-Jewish things, okay, and be okay with it. Even though for 50 years of his life he'd been brought up that way, he had to force himself to, so he had to break out of the things that were compulsive in his life so he could win the lost, especially the Gentiles for him. So that is anything that restricts us and binds us, and we can't just step out of it if we've gone to another culture to win people, that's going to give us a problem. Yes, Sean?
You said like eating food, so having worship to idols. Like, yes. Does he still do that in a way? Like,
that's another topic that we will get to. Food topic, oh, sacrifice to idols. Let's cover it right now before Sean asks the question. And so one of the big problems they had was food offered to idols. Should we still eat it? Because it's belongs to the devil now. And he has this big argument about it, and he says, on the one hand, we all know that the idols are nothing. Mm-hmm. They're just demons, and they're not very powerful. Jesus is much higher. So when we give thanks to God, Lord, I thank you for this food you've given us. I bless it in the name of the Lord. It's completely sanctified. It's no problem. I'm not going to be cut off from the love of God if I eat food that was offered to Zeus at the altar. Yes, we all get that. Okay. On the other hand, if my friend's a Zeus worshipper, and he knows I'm a Jesus worshipper, and he says to me, we're having roast lamb, but it's Zeus. It's dedicated to Zeus, so I won't give you any here. I'll just give you the pumpkins and the potatoes. He's wanting to respect your faith. And if you say to him, oh, I don't care, he's listening. Are you a Zeus worshipper or a Jesus worshipper? Which one are you? You're going to confuse him. That's a bad thing to do. Don't show that. On that case, you go, oh, thank you for honoring Jesus by giving me the vegetables and not making me eat the idol food. Okay, so be smart about what you're doing. Okay, you're allowed to eat it, but it'll probably stop that guy getting saved. Okay, the other option, other thing on it, there's the idol temple. And if everyone, because the way idol sacrifice works is you go to the temple, you kill the animal, you eat it, they have a big party. And sometimes meat that's for the markets, they would kill it, offer it to Zeus, and then they take it, sell it at the market. But if you're in the idol's temple, participating in the idol worship ceremony and eating the food, which is a common way to get food, are we having our party today? John's 21st, we're having the temple, come on down. Okay? And they're all doing their Zeus prayers, Zeus offerings, eat Zeus food, all it's all one big deal. Well, you could do that, but a lot of your people are going to go, are you actually saved? Now you're in the Zeus temple worshipping the Zeus idol. Okay? Buying it at the meat market is one thing, and eating it and blessing it in the name of the Lord and bringing it back to your house and proclaiming Jesus over it. But that's different to being in Zeus's temple while everyone is singing Zeus songs, eating the Zeus food. So you're going to make people stumble and turn away from God, and their faith is going to struggle. If they see you doing that, they think, oh, I don't think that's right, but he's doing it, so I'll do it. And then suddenly they're like doubting their own faith and doubting their salvation and not sure about the things of God. Mistake, bad mistake. Your first priority should actually be other people. It's not the food. The food doesn't matter. What really matters is how you are you benefiting or harming other people. So if you're stopping someone getting saved because you're indulging in something, well, cut it off. So if people think that Christians shouldn't smoke cigarettes, then the Christians shouldn't smoke cigarettes. Because they'll see you smoking and they think, you're not even a Christian. We all know that Christians don't smoke cigarettes. And it's not our job to teach them that, oh, we're not under the law, we're under grace, hallelujah. They have no idea what you're talking about. But they want to know, are you ready for Jesus or not? They want to understand. Okay, and you want to make it clear. Yeah, so that's the sort of, it's really what the unsaved people think a Christian should be like. We should be that plus more.
Yeah.
And what the other people, the new converts, think a Christian should be like, we should be that plus more. So if I've got friends who've just got saved, and they were alcoholics and drug addicts and stuff, and a whole lot, and then they come out of that scene and they've just got saved, and so thank Jesus for freeing me from all that, and they've decided that to stay free, they're never going to drink alcohol, because they'll take me right back to their sinful past, okay? And they come to my place, and I offer them an alcoholic drink, I'm going to crush their faith. They're going to think, oh my goodness, I promised the Lord I would never drink again, but now I'm in the elder's house, he's offering me a drink. I don't want to offend them, what shall I do? Have a drink, I've betrayed the Lord, I've turned my back on Christ, now my heart is broken, right? You're killing your Christian brother by the way you do that. So you need to be so careful that what you're doing is not a stumbling block causing other people to fall.
What about halal food itself?
What about Kalau Pu?
Like, there's lots of arguments about Christians, like, not.
According to what Paul said, you can eat anything you buy at the shops, and it doesn't matter because you've given thanks to God for it, that everything in the earth belongs to the Lord. So, going to a halal festival or whatever and participating in the worship of and the sacrifice of and then participating, that's a different story. But he specifically said you can buy anything at the market and eat it. Just don't even ask.
Even though the money is going to that.
Well, where's the money going? Well, he didn't care about where the money was going. He said you've got to buy your food from somewhere, because then again in those days it was probably either food or no meat, because all the meat was sacrificed, so you probably didn't have a choice.
Yep.
So if you've got a choice and you want to target your money somewhere, that's a different question than is it okay for a Christian, righteous or a holy, sin or good or evil?
Mm.
It's just where do you want your money to go? That's a completely different question.
Mm.
Yes?
Is that the same thing then if you go and visit a temple just to look at it, it's not active? It's different if you're going there to actually worship something.
If I'm on my holiday in Asia and I'm looking at the architecture of all the different temples and all the different things like, that might be interesting. But if I start, if they explain to me that if this incense here means that you'll get long life and this incense here means, and so I light one of each, well, that's obviously not a Christian thing to do.
Mm.
I can look at the architecture, I can study their religion to find out how I could reach them.
Mm.
Why don't they respond to the cross? It's because they think of all these things, well, that's fine. But if I'm participating in what I understand to be idol worship, that's he says, are you trying to make Jesus jealous?
Yeah.
Okay? Are you really think that you can just have a hand in the Lord and a hand in the devil? This is what he says. You've got to choose which one you're in. And if you're in for Jesus, you're in for Jesus.
Yeah.
So that's the arguments go both ways, but primarily it's not about you, it's about how it affects everyone else. And if anyone sees me in an idol's temple burning incense, they're like, what, I thought he was a Christian? That's not a good thing to do. So that's very important. What we do is not about us. This is the primary thing. If you're in Corinth and some people are arguing about Apollos and some people are arguing about Paul and they think, oh, I think Apollos is a better preacher by miles. Paul's only here 1 month a year. Apollos is here all the time and he preaches so much more powerful. Okay? It's not about who do I prefer. Oh, maybe I do think Apollos is better. Maybe I think Paul's better. Oh, but Paul was the founding father of this church. It's not my opinion. It's, hold on, you're dividing the church.
Mm.
Couldn't they just say both?
Yeah, see the whole, that's right. Hold on, you're dividing the church. Taking your side would add to the conflict. So it's very important that what we're doing in everything, we're considering the people that are watching. It's not about us anymore. It's about how are they affected. Okay, should we get married or not? There's a whole lot of verses which I put up on here. Really interesting. This is where we get teaching such as you should marry a Christian and not a non-Christian. From this chapter here. There's an interesting verse, chapter 7, verse 25 and 26. He says some interesting things.
What verse?
Chapter 7, verse 25, 26. Now about virgins, I have no command from the Lord, but I give a judgment as one who by the Lord's mercy is trustworthy. Because of the present crisis, I think it's good for you to remain as you are. So, two things. Some of the parts of this book, he says this is the Lord's word. Okay? Like immorality in the church. That's not just my idea. That's the Lord. Okay? But here, this whole thing about should these people get married or not? Well, I've had to think about it. I haven't had a prophetic revelation, a sign from Jesus. This is what you should do. I'm giving you my advice. Based on the current situation, which we don't really know what it was, based on the current situation, this is what I think. And so there's a difference. He says that a couple of times, that it's not necessarily a command from God. Like, this is like a them, us, and me, right? This is not a them universal command he's giving out, but this is my recommendation for you right now. So you want to be aware of that, yes?
Could he mean by them staying a virgin is doing them a favour because they're not going to indulge in all the sexual immorality?
Yes. That's right. If it's a special class of people and everyone knows a virgin and they don't participate, that might have been a safety barrier. That's right. Everyone knows, you can't come. We're going to a party. Oh, you can't come. But that's okay. We'll send you the photos, right? Or not. Okay. It's possible that there was a famine, and if you had a family to look after, that would be hard work. It's also possible that they had a lot of... who wants to be their family to be tortured? For the name of Jesus. If it's just you, deny Jesus or we kill you. Well, I'm looking at deny Jesus. Deny Jesus or we'll kill your husband, we'll kill your children. That's a different story, right? It's suddenly, that's a crisis that you might want to be careful about. So there's a few, based on the current situation, that's what he said. But basically he said something, basically stage you are. The position in life you're in is not a holy thing or an unholy thing. If you're a slave, it doesn't matter. God thinks you're free. God sees you free. If you're a slave owner, well, that doesn't matter. You're a slave of Christ. Like, it's all just terminology. And as far as, if you're married, well, that's nice. If you're not married, well, that's nice too. Just serve God wherever you are, and when change comes, well, that's okay. That's, those things aren't actually important. It's, are you hearing the word of God and doing the word of God that matters? Okay, so that's his marriage chapter. There's a lot of good stuff in there. One of his comments is, you can actually serve the Lord better if you're single. And that's a challenge to a lot of people, but it's true. And he says, I wish everyone was like me, but you're not. But if you've got the gift of God to stay single, you'll have a lot more effectiveness for the gospel, because you'll be unrestricted. In the same way that if you've got an addiction, that restricts you. If you've got a marriage, family, that restricts you in what you can and can't do. And they just get used to that. And if you think it doesn't, well, you obviously don't understand life at all. But you have to carry that on board, and we have to be aware of that. Okay, here we go. Eating at temples. Well, we've done that. We've talked about that already. That's pretty good. So make sure you're thinking about other people. Okay, propriety and worship. Okay, there's a whole chapter here about wearing hats or long hair in church and things like that. That's a really interesting chapter. Well, we have no time, but that would be awesome to talk about. Another one was their communion, their Lord's Supper. When they met for the Lord's Supper, they didn't have a bread and a biscuit and a drink. They had a family feast meal, right? And the way it would work would be, it's at the rich man's house. The rich man sits over here. I've talked about this before. The rich man sits here. And the poor people and the slaves sit over here. And the food starts at that end. And if there's anything left at this end, well, you might be lucky. And so he's saying, in the church, I'm sorry, never allowed to happen. There should be no difference between the rich and the poor when they come to the Lord's table. So you should all have the same. And if there's not heaps of food, we'll just have a little bit each. And if you want to eat lots, eat it before you come. But at the Lord's table, there should be no discrimination between the rich and the poor or anything like that. Everyone should get the same from the Lord. So a very strong word on that. He's saying it's better off if you didn't have your meetings than to do the things you're doing in your meetings. Okay. Then he talks about spiritual gifts. And I want us to read the scripture. How many people have read the scripture before?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, tell me what the scripture's about.
Love.
Love. It's about love. Very good. I'm glad you can read the first word.
Jesus.
It's about Jesus? Maybe. Jesus' love. It's telling us about not being, how to be loving, right? Patient and kind and not envious or boastful or proud. Blah, 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 blah. So when are we going to apply this passage?
Every day.
All the time.
Every day, all the time. I just want to point out in particular, this is not a wedding passage, okay? That's the problem we have. This is not a wedding passage, okay? This is actually a Sunday service passage, because it actually says this. If I speak in tongues, but I have not love. If I have prophecy, but I have not love. If I get a great giving in the offering, but I have not love, then it's all a waste of time. Okay? So he's basically saying, if you want to excel, you should excel in spiritual gifts. You should have prophecy and tongues and all this stuff. But seriously, love has to be the foundation of everything. Otherwise, it's a complete waste of time. So he's very strong. And all you guys are great with your tongue speaking and your prophecy, and you've got all these spiritual gifts. But where's the love, people? You've got to be, again, it's got to be building up other people. It's got to be making other people strong. If it's not blessing and helping other people, it's an abomination to God. He doesn't like it. Get rid of it. Make sure you're blessing other people with your spiritual gifts. Their church service was a bit of a show of time. Because remember, in their day, the person who was the best speaker was the most respected. So if you could give a good speech, you were more important than the people that couldn't read and write and couldn't speak properly. So now they're like, oh, so the person that can speak in tongues the best is obviously the most holy. So they're all trying to speak in tongues better than everyone else so they can be the most holy person in the church. And of course, all at the same time, that chaos, of course. Right, here's our last one. Technical problem. Our last chapter, chapter 15, is all about the resurrection. Is there a resurrection or not? Some of you say that there's no resurrection. Now, you've obviously got that wrong, unless you're saying that Jesus didn't rise from the dead. And if Jesus didn't rise from the dead, well, why am I doing all this stuff and getting persecuted and stoned? That's a big waste of time. If there's no resurrection, and Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, well, I'm not forgiven. We're all going to hell. This is a big waste of time. You're obviously wrong. That's chapter 15. And then chapter 6, but it's a great logical philosophical argument, but I just abbreviated. Chapter 16, It's even better. Now, after I've told you off and sorted out all your problems, make sure the offering's ready when I come, please. Okay, I'm coming and there's going to be an offering. Make sure it's ready when I come. So that was chapter 16. He was telling them to get their offering ready for the Jewish people. The Jewish Christians in Jerusalem are poor. All the Gentiles that have suddenly received the blessing of God need to give some money to help out the Jews. I'll take it with them. Make sure the money's ready, please. Okay, I'm going to stop right there. We've just finished 1 Corinthians. I want us to play a game. Take one and pass it on. Here. Now, where's the whiteboard, Sean?
We'll grab it.
Go get it. You should have one of those each. I'm giving you an attribute of an apostle, and I want you to think about whether it's a true apostle or a false apostle. Okay? Because, is there someone there, Sean? Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians is all about true and false apostles. So look at your piece of paper. See if you think it's a true apostle or a false apostle. Okay, let's have a look at true apostles and false apostles. Okay, in the middle, trying Jewish heritage and trying to speak football. Okay, true apostles demolish arguments. They delight in wickedness.
There's special traits up there.
They're cold and naked. They're hungry and thirsty. They're called by God. They're comforted in suffering. They aim to please God. They're sincere. They're very bold. They preach for profit. They commend themselves. They have confidence. They preach Jesus as Lord. They're in prison. They're continually in danger.
They preach for profit.
They preach for no. They don't preach for profit.
I'm confused.
Yes. Preaching for profit and commending yourself. False apostles.
Probably not be right.
Okay, there we go. What have we got here? False apostles. Tarnish disobedience. Slap your face. Deception. Letters of recommendation. Preach themselves. Secret and shameful ways, distort the word, take advantage of slavery and exploit. Very good, except that Paul said, when I come, I will punish every act of disobedience. So the true apostle is actually going to bring discipline on the believer. So apart from that, very good. Slap your face, he says, if you're those people that you embrace as your apostles, they slap you on your face, they need letters of recommendation, they distort the word, they take advantage. Boast of work done by others, that's a false apostle. A trained speaker, middle ground of course, but in the book of 2 Corinthians,
yes.
He says, I may not be a trained speaker, but I have knowledge. So their false apostles were trained speakers. They were classy orators. Okay, Jewish heritage. As Paul did have a Jewish heritage, but he had renounced it for the sake of the kingdom. So the false apostles were all boasting of their Jewish background, and he renounced it. So, very good. That's the sum of, we got all of this from his comments about what it's like to be a minister, to be an apostle. Okay, what is the most important thing? So remember, we had a letter to church, Corinthians 0.5. Then we had 1 Corinthians. Then we had
life. I can stop it and play it, but it will be on the side.
Really? Okay. Follow me closely on your piece of paper. We've had 0.5 Corinthians when he writes to them and he tells them certain things. We have 1 Corinthians where he hears what's going on and receives a letter and he writes back again. Then he writes them another painful letter with much tears and weeping, which we don't have. And then he writes to them again when he's not going. He said, we understand. He's writing them and he's saying, I know I said I was going to come to you, but I'm not now. And I want to explain why not. So just ending, our first slide has the end of 1 Corinthians chapter 16. At the end where he's winding up the letter, and he says, now about our brother Apollos. I strongly urged him to come to visit you with the other brothers, but he was not willing to come now. Now this is a very clever moment, because the start of the book was, we love Apollos. Apollos is our favourite speaker. They're fighting over who's their favourite preacher. And Apollos is currently with Paul at Ephesus. And he says, well, I asked Apollos to come to you, but he said, no, he wants to stay with me. So Apollos, by that fact, Apollos has just shown everyone whose side he's on. And he's not on the side of the rebels. He's on the side of Paul as the apostle over the church. So it's like a throwaway line, but of course, when they're reading that book, they've like gone, oh, even Apollos isn't coming. We wanted Apollos to come, and Apollos isn't coming. So it's possible that they were okay then. If Apollos isn't coming, we don't want Paul, we'll make up our own. We'll get some other preacher to be our church apostle. Apostle being, what's an apostle? And the terminology that I'm using now, what's an apostle? It's a jargon word. Anyone know from the apostle?
Does it say in the slides?
It does not say on the slides. Don't read the slides. I've just asked this question spontaneously because I see blank faces looking at me. What's an apostle? Who's in, tell me the names of an apostle?
Paul.
Apart from Paul.
Peter.
Peter, yes. Anyone else?
James,
yes. John, yes.
Leaders, fathers.
Who? An apostle. The apostles, remember, started off as the 12 disciples of Jesus. They're the ones that are sent out with the mission to carry the gospel. Joshua, obviously. Yes?
Is it anyone who's called
going
to carry out the Great Commission?
Yes, basically anyone who's sent to carry out the Great Commission. The word comes from the court system. If you were waiting for the court to decide your case, when they made the decision, the apostle would come and tell you. So if they were the messenger bringing the verdict, or bringing the result, or bringing the message, or bringing the announcement. So that was where the apostle's secular usage was. And the apostle started off being 12 disciples. Remember Judas hung himself, and so he was not there, so there's only 11. And they replaced him with some other guy, who was never mentioned again. Okay, but all of the disciples that went and carried the gospel were known as apostles, like Thomas, the apostle, went to India and Iraq and around there and carried the gospel to all those places. And Peter and James and John all did. They were leaders in the church. And Paul speaks of himself as one who was abnormally born. Like, the apostles had all been well established, and he was outside of them. He was never a follower of Jesus. But he met Jesus on the way to Damascus, had a powerful encounter, and he became an apostle. An apostle was anyone really who's a pioneer spearheading a church, planting churches, a father of areas like nations regarding the Christianity. One of the statements is the things that were done, that Mark an apostle were done among you with great perseverance.
Yeah.
And the things that Mark an apostle are, here you go, this is how you tell if someone's an apostle or not.
Filled with the Spirit.
Miracles.
I don't think an apostle. Signs, wonders, and miracles. He says, the things that mark an apostle, signs, wonders, and miracles, I did among you with great patience and perseverance.
Yeah.
Like, how slow are you? I did all these miracles and stuff, and you still haven't figured out what's going on. So, if you're not doing signs, wonders, and miracles, you should probably not be calling yourself an apostle. But fathers, planters over large areas of churches, obviously very, very senior in the things of God. Well, if there's a problem and we don't know what to do, we ask the apostle.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's how it works. Okay, so Apollos didn't go, so the Corinthian church basically abandoned Paul and said, well, we don't want you here. Well, large numbers of them, we don't want you here. So there's been that problem. Are you clicking in?
Yeah, it's reaching. I can't go back, but...
Right click.
It wouldn't let me right click.
I'll try it. Okay, so here we go. We're up to here.
Just try not to move the mouse.
So... they've had this Paul's been being there, and they didn't like him. He followed up his leader with a visit. They didn't like it, and his church was completely split in half. He says he's going to come back. Titus comes with this other letter, and Paul goes to Macedonia and does some stuff. And that's all in 2 Corinthians chapter 1 and 2. We read about his change of plans and stuff like that. Remember, when you write a letter, it takes maybe 3 months, 6 months to get there. So by the time you get there, everything's changed anyway, by the time the letter gets there. And they write one back, send it back. It takes months before it gets back to you, because it's very slow and a lot can happen. If you've got a church split happening and it takes you 6 months to get a letter back into the force, things can be like quite fast. Okay, the sinner, interestingly, that the person that was sinning badly in 1 Corinthians, he's now repented. That's the one of the situation. He's now, they did what Paul said and they cut him off from the fellowship. He's repented, and so in this book he says, now you've got to bring that guy back. Welcome him back. And embrace him again because he's returned to Christ. So that's pretty good. Now Titus comes back. Sean has the touch.
Oh, you probably moved the mouse.
Oh, maybe I did too. Okay, I broke it.
So look, would it have taken a whole year pretty much before that poor guy was accepted back into the fellowship?
Yes, there could have been a delay. Because these guys are a bit slow, he could have repented, and they said, I'm sorry, Paul. Paul said we've got to kick you out. Oh, you've repented? Well, that's nice, but until we hear about the word from Paul, then Paul's probably like, come on, guys. It's obvious what it was all about. So,
yeah.
So Titus comes back and says that most people have repented. Most people are on your side again, Paul. Things are good. Darkness is over the face of the earth. Okay, but the other people have got other apostles now to come in their place. And so that's a problem. And they're probably Jewish preachers. And so he's got to sort this all out once and for all. A very good quote. I'm just chapter 7, verse 8. 2 Corinthians would be more relevant than 1 Corinthians now. Chapter 7, verse 8. This is a really powerful statement. It gives us an idea of what's going on. Even if I caused you sorrow by my letter, I do not regret it. Though I did regret it, I see my letter hurt you, but only for a little while. Now I am happy. Not because you were made sad, but because your sorrow led you to repentance. For you became sorrowful as God intended, and so you were not harmed in any way by us. Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leads no regret, but worldly sorrow brings to death. So this is a really great insight into his whole dynamic. He really, obviously, was really strict on them. He got really hurt you, I understand that, but that godly sorrow leads to repentance, which leads to salvation and life. And we make a big mistake if we try and fix the godly sorrow problem. If people are receiving conviction and coming and understanding of their sin or whatever and realizing the error of their ways, and we try and fix it and make them feel better too early, we cut off the track. It's godly sorrow, repentance, salvation and life. If you cut it off before it gets to the repentance and life problem, then the sorrow is worthless. And the other problem you can do is you have worldly sorrow, which is sorrow that doesn't lead to repentance and salvation. So those are the things when we're dealing with issues, we've got to look at these things.
Are you on outline, Jeff?
I am now on slide number 6, outline of introduction. I think I've gone way past that. So we have an introduction. Now notice, outline number 6. Okay, slide number 6, he says his explanation of his conduct and why he isn't coming. And it says chapter 1, verse 12, chapter 2, 17, and then chapter 7, verse 2. Remember I told you last week he deviates? So he says, look, I wanted to come to you, but I didn't come because of, this is chapter 1, verse 12, and then at about chapter 2, verse 18, he gets distracted by something really important, and he spends another five chapters telling them about this stuff, and then in chapter 7, verse 2, he comes back and he says, so as I was saying, I couldn't come to you before, but now this is what's happening, and he goes back on track. So be aware, 2 Corinthians especially is really bad. It's not well planned. It's obviously a lot more intense and emotional, and so he jumps all over the place. And so you see this, I was going to come, but I got caught up. And then in chapter 7, verse 2, he's talking away, and then he says, he comes back to, I was going to Macedonia, and then something happened, and he starts telling his story of why his travel plans were changed and stuff like that. Okay, number 7, Paul's reflection on his ministry. He's very strong. We talked about the weakness and strength and stuff. He's very strong that he ministers the new covenant of the Spirit and not of the flesh, not of the law, but of the Holy Spirit. And there's power, but the power is made perfect in weakness. He's very strong. His opponents are saying how good they are at speaking, how powerful they are, all the things they do, how organized they are, what great ministries they've got. And he says, I'm not going to boast on any of those things. You want to know how good my ministry is? Well, this is how many times I've been in prison. This is how many times I've been persecuted. This is how many times I've had no food and I'm starving and hungry and shipwrecked. And these are all the things that show I'm an apostle. So he takes the opposite road to all of his opponents. Right? Because they're very strong on that. God's blessing is on us. Look how awesome we are. Nothing ever goes wrong for us. We're rich, we're famous, we're powerful. And he says, I'm an apostle and I'm a true apostle. And this is my honor road. This is my real. You imagine Paul's promotional video. Now join the ministry of Paul, shipwreck, prison, famine, hardship, none of the things that we all boast about, and the things that even ministries today boast about, how awesome they're doing and how wonderful they are and how many thousands are being saved and stuff like that. Well, he boasts about, I've been in prison for 3 years now, I've been whipped 5 times, I've been shipwrecked, I've spent a night and day drowning in the water. These are the things I'm boasting about. How are we going? Completely opposite spirit of all those of other people. And also, very strong, ministry of reconciliation. Okay, so it's very important that we don't get on the bandwagon of blessing without trouble. Because Paul is very strong. The way of the cross, if there's no suffering, no hardship, no sacrifice in your life, well, you're obviously not following Jesus. Because he led through the cross, and you'll be following, carrying your cross. If you're not carrying a cross, you're obviously not a disciple. So very strong on that. Okay, then he talks about the offering again, chapter 8 to 9. and he's telling them to organise like that, and he's very, like, sneaky. He says, he talks about the Macedonian church, on the next slide if you've got that, Sean. He talks about the Macedonian church, who are a poor church. And he says, out of their great poverty, they overflowed with amazing generosity. And now some, I've told them that your Corinthians are really generous as well. You're really rich and prosperous and you love to give. And so some of them are coming with me. Now, it wouldn't be good for them to come along and find out that you don't have an offering, really, when I come. Because they've given lots and they're poor. And so now I'm sure that you guys, when we get there, will have something equally impressive. So he's really playing on carnal attitudes there. He's not exactly saying ask the Holy Spirit how much you should give in faith. He's saying don't be caught out and embarrassed that you haven't given as much as the poor people. So that's an interesting methodology for an offering.
Yeah, Tash wants to know, is that manipulation?
Yes. If I read it, it sounds exactly like manipulation. He's really putting pressure on them because they're so boastful, and they're not, like, because it's an honour culture, you guys are so boastful, you're boasting that you speak in tongues more than everyone else, you're boasting about your spiritual gifts, you're boasting about ministers. Let's see if you've got, you can put your money where your mouth is.
Yeah, exactly.
The poor people have given an offering, how about you guys?
Yeah.
So he's really challenging them to put their money where their mouth is and prove that they've got something rather than just all talk. Okay, then there's the whole thing about false apostles on the next slide. And I'll talk about that. He just goes into his weakness. And all the things that show how weak he is, and without Jesus, you know, I'd have nothing. He talks about his thorn in the flesh, and I ask God to take it away from me, but he says my grace is made perfect in weakness. When you are weak, then you are strong.
Really,
and he really nailed that. And he says, and the danger, he really understood the danger, when you're successful, when you're making it, and you're awesome, then you're on really slippery ground, because that's when you're about to topple over and become a false apostle, boasting in all the things that actually they're all Jesus things. You've got nothing. So that's why rejoice in weakness and suffering and struggle, because that'll keep your feet on the ground and you'll realise it's all about Jesus and not you.
Next slide.
Next slide. Did it work?
Yes.
Well, we're going to say yes, it did. In Romans 15:25, he says, I'm on the way to Jerusalem, Macedonia and Achaia. Now, Achaia is Corinth. Corinth is a city in Achaia. Have been pleased to make an offering for the poor in Jerusalem. So obviously, the Corinthians came up with some money. So there must, some progress must have been made in the dream. And I'm just going to read chapter 4, verse 16 to 19, and then we're going to stop.
Next slide.
Even if it was just
you can if you like, but I'm completely ignoring it. Chapter 4, verse 16 to 19. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, how's that for a healing anointing? Outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. Our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that outweighs them all. So you've got to get heaven perspective on the things that are going on in your life.
Mm-hmm.
Paul's light and momentary troubles are not a headache. It's not a flat tire. It's being locked up in prison and beaten and stoned and shipwrecked and assassinated. People are trying to kill him and riots. And his light, momentary troubles are working for him and in glory that outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Now that's a powerful statement. There's so many important writings of Paul. He flicks from the physical situation right now to a universal principle and it just pops out. And one of the good things when you're reading his books, you see him talking about the arguments and things, and then he'll pull out a principle that really gives the underlying. And here's his principle. What is seen is temporary. What is unseen is eternal. So all the things we can see, they're the things, not the things we should be worried about.
Mm.
It's the things that we can't see, the things that matter. And so whenever we're getting, and in his case, the things he could see, no matter what's happening, good or bad, around you in the physical, that's not really, it's the unseen things. So things that are unseen. Faith is setting your eyes on the things that are unseen. Jesus is currently unseen. These are the unseen things. Set our eyes on the things that are unseen. The other things that are unseen is our cups of tea and coffee, which I believe by faith are ready right now.